Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadjia Varney, your host. Some educators and parents are concerned that their students are getting shortchanged because of the extreme focus on test scores. They fear that the curriculum is getting narrowed, and they think that the learning opportunities are being limited by teaching to the test. Well, today we're talking about an approach that claims to widen and deepen learning, and it is called project-based learning. And in fact, they say, it will not in any negative way affect the test scores. Project-based learning is promoted by Dr. William Okers. I know Dr. Okers from way back, from the workshops that he did for our school in Attleboro. He's an author, and he is a former professor at Rhode Island College, where, by the way, he received the highest honor and award that's given by RIC, the Mary J. Thorpe Award for Distinguished Scholarship. Dr. Okers has been a consultant to schools in Rhode Island and Massachusetts, and currently he's an adjunct professor at Providence College. And I'm happy to welcome Ms. Cindy DiDonato. She's a former high school English teacher who had a great interest in technology, and that has led her into new fields using technology. And she is currently an adjunct professor at Providence College as well. Welcome.
Thank you, Nadja. It's good to be back again.
Yeah, it's so good to see you, Dr. Okers. We met in the reading world.
That's right.
And I wonder, what brought you into project-based learning?
Well, for a long time, I was interested in the notion of inquiry, where
That's
students
right.
would study a question in depth. And in the course of events, I was working at a school with Cindy, and we said to each other, you know, let's combine my interest in inquiry with her interest in technology. We talked about it, and eventually we said, well, you know, what's happened to that field now is project-based learning. And so
Excellent.
We were off and running.
You were, and you're still running.
Yes.
Isn't that wonderful? What subjects is it used in, or maybe more broadly, how will you define it? What is project-based learning?
Well, the word project is a little misleading. It suggests, you know, the kids are sitting around building a diorama of some object that they're dealing with in the school subject, but it's really about problem solving.
Oh.
Problem solving that deals with authentic, messy questions for which there is no one right answer. And engaging kids in that research to investigate and answer the question, we call it the driving question. And that's basically what it's about. The project part deals with the fact that they don't create something physical as some sort of object, but they might create a PowerPoint presentation, they might create a booklet, they might put on a debate. So there is some project at the end of the line. It all starts with that driving question, which they research. Mm-hmm.
I think I read somewhere in your literature that instead of trying to pull kids through a curriculum, this driving question has them racing through or rushing through themselves rather than you're dragging them through.
Exactly.
Well, you know, for over 100 years, people like John Dewey and others have talked about the importance and the benefits of experiential learning, hands-on, student-centered. Does project-based learning have any research? Because it hasn't been, with that name, project-based learning, hasn't been around that long. No. Is there research to support it?
Well, Linda Darling Hammond came out with a book recently on powerful learning, and right up front in the beginning of the book, she has the chapter on project-based learning, and she asks the question, and she says, is there research support? And she said, definitely yes. This has been researched for some time, and while it's not widely known in this area, yes, there have been a number of studies that support it as being able to do more than we expect of kids when they go to school in terms of standardized tests, and that's something we'll get into as we talk about project-based learning. So yes, there is definite research support for it.
Well, that's good to hear, and I'm going to look to hear more about that because we know we've heard lots of research in the past and even in reading from Dr. Hammond.
Yes.
I'm wondering though, you mentioned how the students work on a project and with the driving question that you just mentioned. But what's the role of the student, really? How is it different from the traditional classroom?
Well, the student's role is one in which the student drives the learning.
What does that mean, the student drives it?
What happens is, as Bill mentioned, the essential question or the driving question generates quite a bit of interest on the part of the student. And so the student, through research, begins to decide that there are answers that he can find or she can find to answer the essential question. And the student very often, as a result of this individual research, gets very motivated. And the hope then is that the student then develops a life learning mode that will make the difference in the future when it comes to any kind of learning.
So the student gets a basic driving question, but then from that, the student has to develop their own questions about it and research about it?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes, and sometimes the teacher may find questions that are worth answering, but very often it's the student who goes on this quest for information because he or she gets excited about the essential question because it's meaningful. It has something to do with the world. It's relevant.
Relevant, and it's his. It's
exactly.
Not, it didn't come from on high somewhere.
Yes.
Well, you must know this. Very interesting. Now let's talk a little bit about the teacher. Because, you know, we said the sage on the stage.
Yep.
And she, from watching a video, the teachers, you sent me a video where teachers
yes.
were talking about it.
Yes.
And they didn't even sound like the guide on the side. It's kind of an unusual role in project-based learning. How does the teacher fit into this?
Well, the teacher certainly needs to have some background about the topic under discussion. And when we work with teachers, they've educated themselves in that regard. But then once they understand enough about the topic and the question comes forth and the students begin to investigate, the teacher provides resources for them. They provide some direction, provide some activities, and even some traditional teaching experiences. But basically what happens is the kids take off from that point off. And now it becomes the student's job to do the work, to actually find the answers to the questions. And the teacher is there helping out as necessary, but not leading the whole program through its paces.
He's not saying, you have to learn these four facts and I'm going to test you on Friday.
No.
Circa 1930, yeah. And some people are still doing that.
Well, exactly.
Yeah. Sadly.
The teacher empowers the student to go on and embrace questions and find information that makes it relevant.
And you've used a few words just now, relevant, finding information. So that must be down your alley because you love technology. How do you incorporate the technology into this whole project-based learning?
Well, project-based learning or inquiry learning technology is a natural for that because it allows students and teachers to go out and do research on the web.
You mean they Google?
Yes, they can Google, they can seek out forums, they can seek out blogs, they can use wikis, which allow them to share information within a classroom or share information internationally.
Wow.
The technology allows them to present, because part of project-based learning is presentation to an authentic audience. Excuse me. And presentation tools are out there on the web. Like Prezi, PowerPoint certainly would be on the local computer, SlideShare, there are many presentation technologies that are available and free.
And that's true. They can't say, we can't do this because the school department can't afford it, can they?
Exactly.
Because your resources are there, as you said, free for the taking.
Right. And technology allows also for communication. The email can be used, e-pals, which allows international communication among classrooms. Skype, free, allows schools to talk to one another internationally, locally. It's all there and it's doable.
Well, wow, your description of it tells me you have quite a handle on all the resources out there for these students, which is great. I know that you're consulting and doing workshops too, so maybe this will get spread around. I wonder, just briefly, could you describe a project? We will be going to a break shortly, but I know the video you sent me talked about Egypt. Now,
yes.
You could use that one if you wish,
sure.
Or any one, but maybe you could just start us off, and if we don't finish it before the break, we'll continue. How does this class happen?
Okay. Well, schools and children middle school have always studied Egypt. Goes way back, pharaohs, pyramids, the mummies. That's been a traditional part of the curriculum. But we've really brought the topic up to date with coming up with a driving question that's very relevant, very authentic, very messy, and that has implications for the kids' lives. I can tell you how we started getting the kids interested in the question.
Yes.
We We took $6.41 in an envelope, and we put it on the table in front of the groups of youngsters.
Now,
and we,
excuse me, did you say you put money?
Real money.
$6.
And 41 cents.
And 41, there must be significance
yes,
to this.
There
okay.
is.
Okay.
And we said, first count it. Let's make sure you can count the money up. And then we said, what could you do with $6.41? And they talked in their small groups about what they could do with the money, and they decided what the answer was. And if they have a family at home of four, it's roughly $25. What could you do with that? And after that discussion, we said, now, do you realize that $6.41 is what every citizen in this country gives to Egypt every year in foreign aid? Do you think we should continue to do that? And that became the driving question behind all the research that they did. That's where it all started.
My goodness. And then they had to figure out, where is Egypt? And why do they need the money?
Exactly.
And should America be giving that money? And when you break it down like that, $6 and change, it kind of stops the argument of, we're giving too much money in foreign aid. Most people wouldn't think of it that way. So we'll talk a little bit more after the break about how you develop something like that, the Egyptian driving question, because there's a lot going on in Egypt. Do you get into the current political scene?
Absolutely,
here?
Because you have to move from the old traditional Egypt to the new Egypt, the Arab Spring Egypt, and you have to talk about this question, should we continue foreign aid? That's right up to date.
So the students now can take that question, and, well, just quickly, where do they go from that? You ask them this question. Now, what do they do?
Okay, Cindy.
Well,
they
do some research. Some of them went out and looked at videos tied in with Al Jazeera network. Some of them would investigate the geography of Egypt and what's going on there, and do we need to be involved and give aid. Other students formulated opinions, pro and con, to create a classroom debate and eventually a formal debate.
Oh.
So all of that became very exciting. It became even more exciting because students went home with this, and parents over the dinner table were discussing this issue and becoming involved in their students' education.
That's quite interesting, too. But did you ever get any letters back from bigoted people who said you shouldn't be talking about that country because it's not America? Have you ever had anybody react that way?
No, we had actually.
The way you handle it is not, you don't deal with it politically.
Because we were simply saying, which side do you want to be on? We weren't saying we should or we shouldn't provide the foreign aid. We said, this is the debatable, messy question that needs to be addressed. You find out what you think the answer should be. So it wasn't biased one side or the other.
Excellent. That's an amazing way to think about topics in a logical and clear way. Well, we have to take a break. But when we come back, we're going to come back to real reality, like, what about the tests? Stay with us. We'll be right with you.
My life is full of statistics. Thing is, I could have dropped out of school and become one myself. But I didn't, because I had people that believed in me. Here's another statistic. 7,000 students drop out every school day. That's one every 26 seconds. It's time that students know that we believe in them.
Inspire a student and share your message of support at boostup.org.
Dr. Okers and Ms. DiDonato, if I'm saying it correctly, lots of people are worried about test scores. Not just parents that usually do worry about those things, but now they're evaluating schools and teachers as well as the students by test scores. How are these students in project-based learning evaluated, and will they be ready for the mandated tests that they had? And some of them are high-stakes tests.
Well, there are a couple of questions there, Nadjia. One about the high-stakes testing. Our concern is whether students who do well in the high-stakes testing that alone are really qualified or equipped to go out into that real world out there. If you look at what they're being tested on, there's the question as to whether those tests really count for something when you have to deal with problem solving that goes on in authentic situations and the world outside of the school world. So we may be spending a lot of time and effort on tests that don't really measure up to helping students to be prepared for their life after their school days are over. And you know, that's one concern. Do project-based learning kids test well? Well, we were talking to a school in an urban area of our state, and they've been doing projects-based learning since their inception about 7 years ago. Oh. And they say, you know, our scores are right up there with everybody else. We're not suffering test-wise.
Great.
And keep in mind, not everything in project-based learning is innovative and new. They certainly do what we call formative assessments, and they do traditional assessments in addition to the big response, which we can talk about in a moment, that occurs with project-based learning. So it's some of the traditional and some of the brand new and innovative stuff that's going on that makes the difference, but we think gets kids ready for that world out there.
Mm-hmm. And I think it should be noted also that through backward design, one can take standards that are there in the school that have to be accomplished by students and teachers and actually make sure that they're going to be incorporated along the way.
Is that what you mean by backward design?
Yes.
Looking at what the tests, I mean, that's really the intelligent way. You look at questions before you start to think about them.
Exactly.
So that makes a lot of sense. And, you know, I just wanted to comment that what you said was so important. The tests as they are set up now, they seem to be more designed to call students and to call schools and teachers into little categories rather than what you're talking about, preparing them for the world outside. But did you want to add more about the evaluation of the students and how they're evaluated?
Well, the evaluation, as Bill said, can be traditional. Students, we're not asking teachers to abandon the quiz or abandon an exam. However, there are more creative ways for students to show and demonstrate their work. And certainly that can be through a full-blown debate or a presentation in front of parents and other students in the school and administrators, or indeed experts can come in and listen to what students have to give and be involved so that the assessment is authentic. Rather than on a piece of paper that a teacher is going to look at and grade, the student is doing something that is meaningful both for him and the world.
Relevance, I hear that coming from everything that you're saying. I won't go into this, but you just so encourages me because for 1 year I taught gifted and talented 7th and 8th graders English and language arts, and I had a guest every Monday morning from the real world who came in and made presentations, and these were brilliant kids who had to learn how to listen to lectures and then discuss them and then debate them.
Yes.
And yet I was considered like, what are you doing over there with these students? It was so unusual, and yet it isn't really. Tell me about your debates, because we had a debate, the 7th and 8th graders, I thought they did quite well. But you're talking about a 6th grade class studying Egypt from ancient to current with all of its uprisings. Now, do they just suddenly have the debate in front of people, or do they work up to it? How does that happen?
Well, they worked up to it.
How does that happen?
They certainly debated within their classrooms because we're dealing with, three classrooms?
Three classrooms.
Though? Three classrooms. So each classroom did research to prepare for the debate. They used technology, they used books, they discussed issues, they chose pro or con, or sometimes were asked to choose opposite opinions.
This is driving me into a big smile because these are sixth graders that are so tired of just saying, here's the book, read it, and you're going to have a test on Friday.
Yeah. And there were teachers that thought perhaps this was setting the bar too high. However, it was not setting the bar too high. The students rose to the occasion, and they had a final debate in front of the school population.
The whole school?
Not the whole school, the middle school.
The middle school,
I suppose you said the middle school. And the debate was stunning in that the teachers sat at their table, the students handled the whole debate, including moderating it, and even students were sitting in the back who had their netbooks at hand to do research for the rebuttal.
You're kidding.
It was beautiful to see these students be so well prepared, know their research. It was so productive that the other part of the sixth grade, the other team, was able to listen to the debate and have a discussion about that debate at the end of the debate. So it was really a gratifying situation to see these sixth graders surpass the bar, in my mind.
Now, when you mentioned that some of the teachers thought the bar was set too high, you know, we read about our not setting expectations mm-hmm. for children mm-hmm. all the time, but setting expectations that are relevant mm-hmm. that you're talking about. Exactly. I think, you know, people say, make it harder, make them work harder, they'll do mm-hmm. better. But if they're doing the same old things of handing out worksheets and more worksheets mm-hmm. and harder worksheets, mm-hmm. that's not what, you know, really challenging children is all about. And it sounds like project-based learning is really challenging the children. Just one other aside about the students when they do these debates. I think when I watched the little video you sent me, they talked about a child or a young boy who just couldn't be turned on. Do you know the story about him? And he was transformed somehow or other. Yes. Do you know what happened with him?
Well, basically what the teachers told us was that kids found their niche. They weren't always going to go up and be a debater on the stage. Some were debaters in the classroom. Some were fact checkers. Did the PowerPoint presentations. And because they had an opportunity to use their talents in different ways, they weren't locked into one way of being evaluated, they were able then to say, you know, I can do this. I can make this contribution to my team, to my debate team. And it doesn't have to be exactly what the person next to me is doing. And if they didn't find they weren't comfortable doing one thing, there was something else they could do, which is the real world.
Yes, exactly. In fact, isn't that what we're hearing from the business world, that they need people who can work as a team? Mm-hmm. They're not looking for lone rangers anymore. The new economy demands that. Mm-hmm. Well, speaking about the new economy and America, everybody talks about how important education is so that the United States doesn't lose its edge in the world, you know. Now, what do the proponents of project-based learning mean when they say, this approach builds 21st century skills? What does that mean in your literature?
What it means is we like to talk about it as the four C's.
Okay.
The 21st century skills are collaboration, communication, creativity, and critical thinking. The collaboration addresses the point that you just made, Nadjia, about working as a group. Not only working as a group within the classroom, but working as a group outside the classroom, either with the community or internationally through technology, that collaboration can occur. And of course, there are softwares and there are items like the software Skype that allows collaboration to occur. And then of course, there's communication. And being able to communicate, of course, means to read and write, which is near and dear to both your hearts, I'm sure, and to mine. Mm-hmm. But communication takes a lot of different forms today. Knowing how to use social media, knowing, again, how to email, even to email and to get information through email. And then, of course, we move on to critical thinking that must occur. And critical thinking can only happen when students are dealing with messy questions, as Bill mentioned earlier. If you have a yes-no answer to a question, that's fine, and there are questions like that. But being able to go beyond yes and no, to understand shades of gray, to understand analysis and synthesis. We had students at the middle school that we worked with that found out when they did research on YouTube that there were two points of view. Now, how do we deal with those two points of view? How do we reconcile that? So critical thinking comes into play. And then finally, we move on to creativity. We need to be creative. We need to come up with new solutions. Mm-hmm. And the new solution can be carving out a new way to handle a bill. For example, in California, Bill, if you recall, they had
referenda, and the students picked one of those referenda, and they had to investigate, and they had to come out on one side of the other as to whether that referenda should be passed in the state, and they had to make a presentation to the public presenting their findings one way or the other.
Amazing.
I want to go back to critical thinking a minute.
So important. We know that from seeing non-critical thinking and reading.
If you look at the traditional classroom, you have a textbook, and at the end of the textbook, there are questions. And you know the answer must be in that chapter, or else the publisher would have pulled a trick on you. But in project-based learning, as Cindy was just mentioning, it's not just one source of information, that one textbook with one easy answer somewhere in that chapter. There are lots of textbooks, there are lots of sources, and you've got to weigh all of these. And the question that's asked, as Cindy also pointed out, is not one that has one single correct answer. That's how you build critical thinking. Multiple sources, messy questions.
And that makes sense for the 21st century, because we see what's happening in our world today. Somehow, some of the lack of that kind of collaboration and critical thinking, communication, and creativity. It's, we're still into the right and wrong without the gray area in many cases. So in just 20, 30 seconds, can you tell me, do you feel frustrated by any of moving this forward, or do you have a sense of optimism in just a few words?
Cindy, go.
How do you
go first? Well, first of all, the thing that frustrates me is getting the word out about project-based learning. And so that's why it's so wonderful to be here today with you, Nadjia, to explain what it's about and the need. And of course, following that, professional development needs to occur, and we need school districts and administrators to be on board and support. So that certainly is a frustration. But the optimism is the chill I get every time I listen to the videos that we've taped about teachers and their excitement, their passion, and then the students, their excitement and passion as well.
Well, thank you, Dr. Oker, Cindy DiDonato. Thank you so much for taking time to talk with me about project-based learning. In closing, it seems to me that project-based learning is meeting the definition of what education is, as expressed by the late reformer, Dr. Ted Sizer. He said, education is learning to use your mind well. I think that's the purpose of school, and of course for School Talk.